Harper Audio presents Common Sense for the Common Good, Libertarianism as the End of Two-Party Tyranny, by Gary E. Johnson. This is the author. Preface. At the risk of adding fuel to the fire, Donald Trump ignited by using songs from the legendary recording artists Queen, Neil Young, R.E.M., and Adele without permission, I have to say this. If the American people had their way, the theme song playing in the background of their rally for a reimagining of the electoral process would be the Rolling Stones. I can't get no satisfaction. Well, Hillary Clinton got approval from the singer Rachel Platten to use Fight Song, the Democrat did opt for the combative in choosing it as her official anthem. She's come under fire in social and traditional media for not selecting a Katy Perry tune. Regardless of the two major party candidates' taste in music, few Americans would be singing Clinton or Trump's praises anyway. They'd be trying to shout them down, stifling them like an unwanted child at a rally. On top of that, the headlines seem to be screaming at us with regularity as polling data comes in. Voter satisfaction with presidential candidates lowest in decades, reads the label on a June 2016 Pew Research Center reports graphic. And if we're to believe other polling data, it's not just the two candidates themselves who have voters on edge. Those polled, and there were 6,000 of them, more than five times the typical poll sample size, feel that their identity and well-being are in jeopardy. Nora Kelly's article on voter dissatisfaction in April 2016 issue of The Atlantic ran with the intro line, "A new Quinnipiac survey shows most Americans believe the country has lost its way." Kelly goes on to cite specifically how a majority of Americans believe that the country has lost its identity, that their values and beliefs are under attack, and that they are falling further and further behind economically, among other complaints. So that pulsing bass line you hear beneath the doom and gloom melody and lyrics does offer hope that your desire to see things improve will be met. You can hear it if you manage to filter out the rest of the noise. 64% of those who participated in the Quinnipiac survey indicated that they were in favor of radical change. Donald Trump and Bernie Sanders' most ardent supporters believe that their guy was leading a movement and not just a campaign. Radical change and movement sounds like a revolution, doesn't it? I'm here to tell you that Trump and Sanders don't display the kind of radical thinking that the majority of Americans find palatable. In Sanders' case, that doesn't really matter anymore. He is no longer a candidate. Trump's volatility has him and his people now actively engaged in walking back his talking back. In the meantime, Mrs. Clinton has to fend off name-calling from her Republican co-star. She's a liar. She's the devil. She's a co-founder of ISIS. In my mind, I can hear someone putting those lyrics to a catchy tune. I have some sympathy for her, even though she didn't take the high road and called out, deservedly so, Trump as a racist. I guess that when you've been in the political game as long as she has, patience can be in short supply. At times, when I turn on the news and the election coverage, I wonder if I'm mistakenly getting a recap of a Mexican telenovela. I probably shouldn't make light of the situation like this, except like many of you, I need to do something to get rid of the angst that affects these times and threatens to invade my psyche. Back to that glimmer of hope I mentioned. That call for radical change is something that I'd like to see brought about, and not just at some point in my lifetime, but now. If it hasn't been made clear to all of us before, it has become apparent today. The two-party system is broken. Many, including me, are sounding the death knell of the Republican Party. Our representative democracy appears to be in shambles. If a supporter of one party is putting a best foot forward, it's only to trip up a member of the opposition. I apologize. The epic dysfunctionality we're witnessing isn't really funny. It's sad. And forgive me in advance if I'm preaching to the choir. A September 25, 2015 Gallup poll, the most recent available on this question, showed that 60% of Americans believe that a third major political party is needed because Republicans and Democrats do such a poor job of representing the interests of the American people. This trend in favor of a third party began in 2003, but the percentage of those in favor of them is the highest it's ever been. That's more than a decade of growing desire. Isn't it time someone did something to bring about this major change? The time to take the next big step is now. Attaining major party status is a difficult task. It will take an enormous amount of resources and likely a large amount of time. That said, we can all take action today. We can get behind one of the third party candidates in this year's election. These parties may not have attained major party status, but some have ideas that are reflective of what most Americans believe and will put into practice what most Americans want. I believe that the Libertarian Party best fits that description, a group that has the right ideas and the right practices that represent most Americans. Sounds like a major party to me. This level of disillusionment, distrust, and dysfunction hasn't happened overnight. When I served as the Republican governor of New Mexico from 1994 to 2002, I saw firsthand some elements of it. I soldiered on and made some real changes in how our government went about its business. From the start, I was the quintessential outsider. I'd never run for public office before. I'd been a member of the Republican Party since 1978, and with two exceptions, in 1984 I chose Libertarian candidate David Berglund over Ronald Reagan, and in 1992 I voted for Ross Perot because of my concerns over the deficit. I voted Republican every election. In 2000, I was the only governor to not endorse George W. Bush in the primary, believing Steve Forbes could deliver the same results to the country that I was able to achieve in New Mexico. I was a social liberal in a party of social conservatives. In a very real sense, even before I left the Republican Party to join the Libertarian Party, I was a third-party candidate. I was a member of a small subset of like-minded individuals who didn't mind stating our beliefs in the face of opposition from within our party. Yes, divisiveness existed back then, both within and without the party. To one degree or another, in American politics, it always has. But in no time has the dualistic Republican-Democrat, I'm right, you're wrong, yes, no, on, off, black, white, way we talk to and interact with one another in the political sphere been such a yawning, read shouting, chasm. I've sometimes heard people say that when things fall to pieces, it's because the center cannot hold. We have a broken system. There are those who, rather than stand back and watch its continued slow demise, would like to shatter it. That sounds frightening to many. But I believe that a new center will hold. The Democrats and Republicans, particularly as represented by Hillary Clinton and Donald Trump, have ceded their claim on the political center in this country. They've each taken an authoritarian stance, one on the left, one on the right. In both cases, they are deniers of freedom. Fortunately, as the saying goes, nature abhors a vacuum. In that vacated space, I see an opportunity for another mode of political thought to occupy the central place in American politics and governance that both major parties have tried to lay claim to. Libertarianism is on the move, and I believe that it now occupies that middle position, the place where the vast majority of Americans feel most at home, a place where those who are socially inclusive and fiscally conservative can find comfort. In writing this essay and entitling it Common Sense for the Common Good, I want to examine the current state of affairs and look at the root causes that have brought the two-party system to crisis: the absence of common sense and a focus on the common good. I also want to share with you my political history and evolution. At one point in my life, I've been a registered Democrat, a registered Republican, and a registered Libertarian. I've held public office as a Republican, and I've run for office as a Libertarian. That's not inconsistency. That's following my conscience. From the beginning, as I developed my political consciousness, I knew that I had Libertarian leanings, even though I did not join the Libertarian Party. From my unique perspective as a one-time member of three political parties, I'll look at how it is possible for a third-party candidate to thrive in the present environment. And I'll offer evidence that libertarianism is, as I stated earlier, the new center of American politics. We live in an interesting political climate, to put it mildly. Examining how we got here and what it's like to be here will help us do something that I believe the vast majority of the American people can get behind: move forward. Part 1: The Crisis of the Two-Party System. We have a long-standing tradition in the United States of individuals speaking up at times of crisis. Thomas Paine, one of our founding fathers, stepped up in 1776 to make a case for why the colonists should cut ties with their British overseers. I can't say that Paine's seminal work, Common Sense, had a profound effect in shaping my own thinking. Of course, I was aware of its existence, but to be honest, it never left a lasting impression. I did like the title, mostly because it resonated with the approach I took to politics and governance. I believe that most people would like to see common sense restored to America generally, and to the political sphere specifically. If there's one point of agreement now among those who stand at any point along the political spectrum, it's this: enough is enough. Actually, I think we are well beyond the tipping point. We've been knocked off the two-party teeter-totter and have landed in the territory of too much is too much. Come to think of it, we do have something in common today with Paine and the rest of the revolutionaries turned Americans. At that time, the colonists, us, were ruled by a distant and seemingly indifferent government. Back in 1776, you could stand on any street or go into a public house and hear people grousing about the British government. Mostly, it seemed that far-off government was far more interested in serving its own interests than in supporting the colonists. They just didn't get it. They didn't live like us, and yet they wanted our money, and they wanted us to obey the rules they imposed on us. They were busy with their own problems. The monarchy, the House of Lords, and the House of Commons were busy battling each other, waging little wars and making power grabs. They all had their own interests and obligations to various factions. So much of that had too little to do with how our lives were being lived in America. Too much time spent trying to stay in power, fending off anyone who might take the tiniest sliver of power from the larger pie. Power. Self-interest / self-preservation. Inventing new ways to get their power fix by meddling in private matters. Sounds familiar, doesn't it? From the revolutionary's perspective, it wasn't so much about power and control, it was about liberty and freedom. Maybe those are the flip sides of one another. But as is true of much else in life, perspective is what really matters most. The most important balancing act. I think most Americans would agree that liberty and freedom are the founding principles that guided this country's formation. I think most Americans would say that power and control are a necessary part of living together in common. What's needed is a balance among those concepts. How much should we give? How much should we get in return? If I let you take control of this, then what am I going to be able to do or get in exchange for giving that up? Freedom and liberty. Power and control. For quite a while, it seemed as if we had that balancing act down pretty damn good. At home and abroad, we managed to carve out a nice niche for ourselves. Eventually, through a lot of hard work, we managed to expand that niche to extend to the borders of this beautiful landscape. We became a model for others to follow who wanted their own taste of freedom. We stepped in as needed to defeat imperialism, fascism, Nazism, and various other aggressors who were anti-liberty. We were that proverbial beacon on the hill, that shining light. What happened? How did we get here? How did we end up defeating tyranny from without, only to replace it with an encroaching tyranny from within? I want to make it clear from the outset that I don't think America has lost its way, but I do believe there are those among us who would lead us astray. Why do they want to do that? For many of the reasons I stated above, mostly because they put self-interest and the needs and desires of a few ahead of the common good. Ultimately, it's about those whose balance has tipped in favor of power and control, and against freedom and liberty. Today, who are the most prominent representatives of this imbalance in favor of power and control? The two major party candidates for the presidency, Donald Trump and Hillary Clinton. Remember my reference to campaign songs? In Trump's case, using them without asking is exactly what an authoritarian would do. Not just that, the assumption that other people, the recording artists, must agree with his position is an authoritarian assumption. How bad has it gotten? Not to the point where irreparable harm has been done, but far enough that we can't let things go on like this any longer. Common sense principles applied to serving the common good. This is how we can restore our balance. What frightens me is this: the imbalance between power and control on one hand and freedom and liberty on the other has become so obvious that only 19% of the American people trust their government to do what's best for them. How are they going to feel when they have to choose between two candidates who have already demonstrated that they are politically and temperamentally authoritarian? We don't have to guess. We know. How do we know? Because you are telling us right now in the polls. Not only that, you're sharing your dissatisfaction on street corners, in bars, on Twitter, on Facebook, on other social media, on traditional media, on your smartphones, on your home phones, on radio talk shows, in your blogs, online, in line, 24/7, 7 days a week, twice on Sundays, with your friends, family, and strangers. Some of you are shouting. Some are whispering. Some are swearing, some are crying, and you know what? I don't believe that Donald and Hillary are even listening. They might be hearing some sort of indistinguishable rumble, but they aren't really listening to you. They're too busy devising strategies to get you to listen to them, to get you under their control. And it should come as no surprise that so few of us believe that our public officials are listening to us. By one measure, only 24% of Americans believe that public officials are truly listening and responsive. And I'm not talking about the National Security Agency here. I'm talking about listening to us, not listening in on us. Why are these rumblings out there? Because you don't want to give them the control they want to take from you. You like your freedom, and you're not going to give it up without a fight. That's why things have gotten so nasty in our public discourse. Someone is trying to take from you something you love and treasure. You're not going to hand it over quietly. You're going to kick and scream.
We hope you enjoyed this preview. To continue listening to this audiobook on Google Play Books, use the link in the video description.